Hello, I'm Trent Roberts, Soil Fertility Specialist with the University of Arkansas System Division of Agriculture. Today we're going to be discussing potash or potassium deficiency in the major row crops grown across the state. For most of our row crops, potassium is the most limiting macronutrient following nitrogen. For crops like soybean and peanut, it can oftentimes be the most limiting nutrient, reducing yield in our production systems. Potash deficiency symptoms are most often seen on our lighter textured soils, which can include sands, sandy loams, and silt loam soils. These are the areas where we're most likely to see a potash deficiency occur. Areas of the state that are more prone to this tend to be west of Crowley's Ridge and include the counties of St. Francis, Cross, Poinsett, Craighead, and Lawrence. Researchers with the U of A System, Division of Agriculture, have worked hard to correlate and calibrate soil test data, which allows us to predict when and where we can expect a potash deficiency symptom to occur, which may limit yield. What this allows us to do is take corrective measures and apply that fertilizer pre-plant in order to prevent the deficiency from occurring. Effective soil sampling is the first step in preventing potential potash deficiencies, and when done correctly, can help eliminate the potential for this nutrient robbing yield. We use soil test potassium categories to help define crop response to soil test nutrient concentrations. In Arkansas, these categories give us a relative idea of the rate of potassium fertilizer needed to maximize crop yield, as well as the level of response for that particular crop in that particular soil test category. Timing of soil sampling following previous crop harvest can be critical for soil test potassium concentrations. We want to allow ample time for potassium to leach out of the previous crop residue before we take soil samples to identify potassium soil test concentrations. Another useful tool is scouting and proper identification of potash or potassium nutrient deficiency symptoms for our major row crops in Arkansas. So we're going to start with potassium, potash, or K deficiency symptoms in corn. Since potassium is a mobile nutrient in the plant, we're going to tend to see those deficiency symptoms occur on the oldest lower leaves first. You can see that this particular leaf has kind of senesced, and so as we move up to the next older leaf on the plant, we can start to identify those deficiency symptoms that are typical for grass crops such as corn, grain sorghum, rice, and wheat. And so in this particular example with potash deficiency, we see firing of the leaf margin starting at the tip and working its way towards the base. This is a pretty typical symptom of potash deficiency as we get these leaf margin firings first that move inward towards the midrib and down from the tip towards the base of the leaf. Now we're going to talk about potash or potassium deficiencies in rice. Similar to corn, potassium deficiencies are going to show up first on the lower, older leaves. A lot of times with rice, we don't start to see those potassium deficiencies until 3 to 4 weeks post-flood, when the plant really starts to increase vegetative growth or begin to go into that reproductive growth cycle. Since it's on the lower portion of the plant, unless it's moderate to severe, it may be hard to identify unless you move that plant canopy back and actually look and focus on those lower, older leaves. So if we focus on the lower, older leaves of this particular rice plant, we can easily identify potassium or potash deficiency. As you can see here, this lower, older leaf is showing the typical symptoms of potash deficiency. Similar to what we saw in corn, we get this firing of the leaf margins that starts at the tip and works its way towards the base of the rice plant. This can be hard to identify due to the density of the rice crop canopy. You've really got to move those leaves back and look at the lower canopy to help see these deficiency symptoms. Cotton is the first broadleaf row crop that we'll talk about, and depending on the timing of the onset of deficiency and the severity, can show up at varying levels in the plant canopy. This is a good example of moderate potassium deficiency in cotton. As you can see, we have marginal chlorosis around the leaf edges, beginning at the tip and working its way towards the center of the leaf. Now we're going to focus on potash or potassium deficiency symptom identification in soybean, which can be one of the most complicated of all the row crops we grow in Arkansas. One unique characteristic of soybean, especially our indeterminate soybean crops, are that they have vegetative and reproductive growth occurring simultaneously. So the idea of potassium being a mobile nutrient which shows up on the lower, older leaves first is not always the case. As you can see here with this particular crop, we have severe potash deficiency in the upper portion of the canopy. So similar to other crops, potash deficiency in soybean is going to be marginal leaf chlorosis or necrosis that starts at the tip and moves towards the base. Another useful tool is tissue testing, which can help to confirm a potassium deficiency symptom or can be used to identify hidden hunger. Hidden hunger is a term we use to describe when plants are exhibiting yield loss from nutrient deficiency prior to when we actually see the deficiency symptoms in the field. For most of our major row crop species, proper identification of potassium deficiencies early in the season can be corrected. Depending on the crop, the growth stage, and the level of deficiency, corrective measures can be taken to recover yield and optimize yield in many cases. If you have any questions concerning soil testing or tissue analysis for potential potassium deficiencies, please contact your local county extension agent.